The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. Please friend me on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter. On today's show, comedian Frank Santorelli. You might recognize him from The Sopranos. He played Georgie, and he's an hysterical comic out of Boston. Old friend of mine. Great conversation. And then we go to Regina, Canada, to talk to Jeet Heer. He's the senior editor at the New Republic magazine. Jeet talks to us about the alt-right, neo-Nazis, and their sense of humor. So we're going to talk about comedy today with a comedian and an editor over at the New Republic. Hey, we are stepping up our efforts to fight Mr. Trump legally within the system. That's the best way to take on a potential fascist. I think he has the potential to, well, the Republic is already destroyed. This is time for our second Republic. First step is to peacefully, legally remove Donald Trump from office. I know that's wishful thinking, but we have to fight him every step of the way. You have to fight these people every step of the way. How do you do it? How do you do it? They can't count our votes. Jill Stein is doing recounts in Michigan, in Pennsylvania, and in Wisconsin. Conventional wisdom is it's not going to change anything, but it's important to count the votes. They can't really count our votes, and if you're a person of color, they won't let you vote often. But one thing they do count is your money. That's what people care about. Christmas season is upon us, and your biggest vote in the United States is what you do with your money. That they can count. Despite what Donald Trump says, the New York Times is doing very well, thank you very much. In fact, they announced that since the election, New York Times subscriptions have gone through the roof. More and more people now are subscribing to the New York Times. You can get a subscription to the New York Times. You can get a subscription to the Washington Post, to the Nation magazine. These are important magazines and periodicals that you need to support. You go to davidfeldmanshow.com, hit our Amazon banner, search magazine subscriptions, and get a subscription to the New York Times for your loved one. Get one for the Nation magazine. The Washington Post, yes, it's owned by Amazon. But the Washington Post is doing some great reporting. The Los Angeles Times, support your local newspaper, and you can get a subscription for these magazines and newspapers on Amazon, and I'll get a small piece of it because I need to keep my lights on. Hey, now, not only can you vote by spending money, you also vote by not spending money. Yes, boycotts. Yes. You notice that Glenn Beck disappeared, especially from, you know, cable news. He went off and did, I think, is it called The Blade or something? But that's going out of business. You know why Glenn Beck disappeared from Fox News? Because we boycotted his advertisers. Remember? Rush Limbaugh. We don't really know how much money Rush Limbaugh makes these days. You know why Rush Limbaugh is becoming more and more irrelevant? Because we are boycotting his sponsors. Did you know that? Do you know the power you have in boycotting advertisers? Breitbart News was set up by Andrew Breitbart, who passed away in 2012. It is an alt-right news rag on the web that promotes alt-right theories, racist, homophobic, misogynistic tracts are published, protecting the Confederate flag. They write pieces attacking women, people of color, defending your right to wave the Confederate flag. Well, Steve Bannon is one of Donald Trump's chief advisors, and Steve Bannon runs Breitbart.com, which traffics in fake news. Like when Donald Trump says 3 million votes were cast illegally in last November's election, he gets that information from Breitbart, which doesn't traffic in information. It traffics in innuendos and lies. Here's what you can do. You can boycott anybody, any company that advertises on Breitbart News. That's how they make their money. They make their money through advertising. And if you let the advertisers know that you're going to boycott their product, if they continue to support Breitbart, you can actually put Breitbart out of business. According to Salon Magazine, Kellogg's, you know, the people who give you high-fiber cereal, they have pulled their advertising from Breitbart, and Breitbart is announcing that they want their readers to boycott Kellogg for boycotting Breitbart. You know, Breitbart is so full of crap, I doubt they use any of Kellogg's products, since Kellogg's tends to have high-fiber cereal. So, if you like freedom, if you hate neo-Nazis, you might support Kellogg and use their cereal because they are boycotting Breitbart. Allstate Insurance, Nest Labs, Earthlink have all removed their advertising from Breitbart, according to Salon. And the companies that have yet to remove their advertising are BMW, the German automaker, Chipotle. They've already given us a virus, and now they seem to be promoting an even more toxic virus, Breitbart News. Dell Computers and Chase Bank, as of Tuesday of this week, are still advertising on Breitbart. So here's what you do. Obviously, we're not going to buy a BMW, even if we had the money. We're not going to Chipotle. You know, Chipotle, actually, it's pretty healthy food when they're not killing you with filth. Dell Computers and Chase Bank. To be honest with you, I have a checking account with Chase. So here's what you do. You can stop using these products, but you can also go... Now, where is this? Let me find it. Go to, I hope you all have Twitter accounts, go to Sleeping Giants. It's a recently formed Twitter account that has been tracking ads that are appearing on Breitbart.com. Sleeping Giants is a new Twitter account. And what you do is you follow Sleeping Giants, and they will give you updates every day on companies who are, that are, well, be who. According to Citizens United, it would be companies who are advertising on Breitbart. It's called Sleeping Giants. Here's their handle, at SLPNG_Giants. And in the background, you hear the police coming for me. At SLPNG_Giants, follow them. They will give you updates on how to boycott anybody who is supporting Breitbart. And they give instructions. Their pinned tweet on their Twitter page is how to be a giant. One, look on Breitbart and take a screenshot of an ad. Two, tweet it to the advertiser with a polite note. Three, tag it at SLPNG_Giants. So, do you know how to get a screenshot of an ad? I don't know how to instruct you on how to do a screenshot, but it's really easy to do. Just Google how to take, because I don't know what kind of computer you have. So just find out how to take a screenshot. And if you can't take a screenshot, if it's too complicated for you, just tweet to the advertiser with a polite note, why are you advertising on Breitbart? And then be as angry or as kind as you want, and then tag it at SLPNG_giants, sleeping giants, at Twitter. Am I being clear here? Do you understand that you can use Twitter to really scare the hell out of advertisers? So you might want to tweet at BMW, tweet at Chipotle, tweet at Dell Computers, and tell them you're no longer going to buy their products until they remove their support, their advertising on Breitbart News. This is really important. Your vote counts, but your money counts even more. Your threats not to use a brand terrifies corporate America more so than your votes. This is the real power that you have. This is the real power of social media. Have you ever complained on social media about an experience on an airline or with a bank or with a computer? Try it. Just, you know, if you're having a problem with your Apple computer, tweet at Apple computer so all your followers can see it. They will get back to you before you're finished with the tweet. They are terrified of your influence with your followers on Twitter. And I'm saying, if you have 3 followers on Twitter, trust me on this. They have people monitoring Twitter to make sure that their brand is being protected. When you start tweeting out at companies on Twitter that you're going to boycott them unless they pull their advertising from Breitbart, trust me on this. This is more powerful than your vote because it's being counted, because it's about money. And you don't see Glenn Beck on Fox News anymore. And there's a reason for that. And that's because we boycotted and we announced a boycott about 5 years ago. Boycott anybody who sponsors Glenn Beck. You have no idea how powerful this is. Rush Limbaugh is becoming irrelevant. See who advertises on Rush Limbaugh. You can make Breitbart News disappear by threatening the advertisers. How to be a giant? Go to Sleeping Giants on Twitter. They're at SLPNG_giants. Follow them. They will give you daily updates on who is advertising on Breitbart News. Then, when you see a call to action, like the NFL today has an ad running on Breitbart, and people who follow Sleeping Giants are either taking screenshots, if they can do it, or just tweeting at NFL, informing them that they're advertising on Breitbart, and we are no longer going to support your product if you continue to support Breitbart News. And the NFL will pull their advertising. Trust me, ratings are down. They're terrified. They're getting bad publicity. They have enough problems damaging the brains of their players. They don't want to be responsible for damaging any more brains by supporting Breitbart News. Okay. That's our call to action today. A lot of you are helping me promote information and news. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Contact me. Send me information. That's our call to action for today. On our show, Frank Santorelli from The Sopranos, and then the senior editor for the New Republic magazine, Jeet Heer. Joining us in Boston, Massachusetts, is Frank Santorelli. Frank is best known for playing the recurring role of Georgie the bartender in The Sopranos. That's how you know him. But he's also a world-class stand-up comedian. You are. And
world-class.
You
absolutely
are.
Got that right.
You are. And you'll be at the Mohegan Sun in Uncasville, Connecticut on December 14th. And if you live in Newport, Rhode Island, on December 3rd, Frank will be at the Grand Hyatt performing. Go see Frank Santorelli, a great, great comedian, a great actor. Hello there, Frank.
Hey, David Feldman, one of the all-time greats, man. I miss you.
Continue.
I miss you. I haven't seen you. And how long has it been since I've actually seen you?
I don't know, but I cannot tell you the number of times I'm on the phone with Brian Kiley, the great comedian and comedy writer. And, and I say, I need to hear Santorelli. I need to hear Santorelli tell me what to do, to give me advice, to tell me it's okay to own my feelings.
Well, I get huge laughs whenever I'm with Boston comedians, because I'll just break in and go, let me tell you, you want to know something? You know who's a real jerk? Brian Kiley. And people just break into hysterical laughter because that's exactly what he's not.
Yeah.
He's like one of the most well-respected and wonderful human beings that we all know. I'll say, you know who really is boorish and you can't get a word in? Brian Kiley. He's a jerk, man. Everybody just laughs.
The only person who doesn't like Brian Kiley is Brian Kiley.
That's right.
There's nobody. Exactly. I don't know anybody who's
exactly.
a bad thing. So
exactly.
You, let's do some... you know, homework here and
sure.
explain who Brian Kiley and
who I am,
who you are,
who you're exactly talking.
When did you start doing stand-up comedy?
I started in 1981 at the Cleveland
Comedy
Club.
Are you just going to talk about yourself for the whole, Jesus,
with Drew Carey. I started with Drew Carey and he makes $11 million a year and I'm in Uncasville, Connecticut, in the back room of a warehouse. I started in 81. I really did start with him. I didn't meet him ever. I've only met him one time, like out in front of the Improv, like about 10 years ago. But we never really crossed paths. He left right as soon as I got there. I started there, moved to Boston in 85. As you know, the comedy scene was booming. 7 comedy clubs, about 61 nighters. Barry Katz was booking. Everybody was booking things. Mike Clark had 90 rooms. It was ridiculous how much work there was. And so I moved to Boston and never looked back. And I used to go to New York and do auditions and stuff, and that's how I got a manager and an agent and everything. And so if you go on my IMDb, I've done a ton of stuff, TV, little spots on television, Law and Order with Jerry Orbach, Spin City with Michael J. Fox, Providence, Las Vegas with James Caan. Oh, yeah. I don't think these people know who you're really talking to here.
Either do you. You need help. I have a good psychologist. So you're born in Cleveland. I didn't know that about you.
I was born in Cleveland, Ohio, and the Indians broke my heart. I'm wearing a black jacket right now with the Chief Wahoo insignia on it right now, and it is ruffling feathers wherever I go. People are like, Chief Wahoo? Get rid of that guy. Well, I said, he's not as bad as Chief Nakahoma. For the Atlanta Braves. So bad he doesn't even have a logo. That's just his name. Chief, isn't that the worst? It's worse than Chief Wahoo. Chief Nakahoma.
Is he Japanese?
All I can remember is Jane Fonda and her husband Ted Turner with the tomahawk chop. Right. Yeah.
Well, do that bit in Uncasville, Connecticut at the Mohegan Sun.
Right.
Living in Boston, so you've been living in Boston since what, 80?
Oh, yeah, I've been living here a long time, since like 1985, and I never looked back. This has been my home. I raised 2 daughters. I got 21 and 18-year-old daughters.
Hmm.
And, so that's a lot of responsibility right there for a sleazy late-night stand-up comedian.
Well, I'm going to apologize because
You should. You should be apologizing to me right away for whatever is coming.
I hate to bring up The Sopranos. The only thing, and I apologize because there's so much more to you than The Sopranos. So let's get this out of
sure.
Let's get it out of the way.
Sure.
You know, everybody wants to bring up when they interview me. The Mouly massacre when I was working with Lieutenant Callie in March of 68 when we massacred a small village.
Yeah, I got The Sopranos. I went to an audition, and I don't know if you saw the episode where I got beat up with the phone.
That episode? No, I never saw that. Did Tony used to beat you up with a phone? Because
he did. That was my sort of MO, right? I was in 16 episodes, and then 12 of them.
I'm being sarcastic. I'm being, let me, are you kidding me?
I know a lot of people say, no, I never watched it.
Are you kidding?
I was like, what? Oh, yeah. I get people all the time. No, I never watched it. I didn't get HBO. And
oh, no, I could.
Are you kidding?
I have seen every episode of The Sopranos at least 20 times. At least.
Right. Right. So you've seen me get beat up. Okay, so the first episode.
Well, I know that you lost your eye. You lost your eye.
Because, oh, yeah. Ralphie. Ralphie rips my eye open with that cane with the lock at the end of it. Right.
From Gladiator.
That's one of them. Yeah, that's a big one. I'm in a lot of scenes in that one. I'm in like 12 scenes in that episode.
All that
more over, than Gandolfini.
All that over a hooer.
That's right.
From that episode.
And so I went to this audition, and Georgiana Walken is in there. Christopher Walken's wife is the head of the casting department for The Sopranos.
Wow.
And so I go in, and the lines are, hello, hello. I'm talking on this old-fashioned phone, and it's a menu. And I'm going, hello, 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 hello. That's the lines. And somehow I made them laugh, and then they looked at me, and I said, listen, if I get this part, I'm going to need more lines than hello. And they all, everyone cracked up except for Gandolfini. He kind of looked at me like, who is this guy? You know? And then I got the part.
Oh, but
and
Gandolfini was,
for one day.
Was he in the room? He was in the room when
he
you were.
He was in the room. Absolutely. He was in the room. And I knew him from only, Crimson Tide. He was in the movie Crimson Tide. He was in a civil action with John Travolta. He was in a small scene in that. He was wonderful. And he wasn't really known yet.
No.
And so anyway, everybody laughed, and I got the part. It was a one-day shoot. And while I was there, I was being Frank Santorelli. I was balancing things on my nose and just being funny and goofing around. And they took pictures of the tattoos they put on me. And the girl at the makeup room said, this is great. I said, why? She said, that means you're coming back. I said, it does? And she said, yeah. They wouldn't take a picture of your tattoos if they didn't want you to come back. So sure enough, I came back and 17 episodes actually aired. And I was in, I taped 18 of them. So I was in a bunch.
Wait, there's another episode? There's another episode that we haven't seen yet?
I think, well, there's one that they left on the cutting room floor.
Really?
And, yeah. Oh, yeah. That's one that, there's one they taped that they never showed. And it was after I got beat up really badly, and Tony Sirico, Paulie Walnuts, goes, he don't want to see you no more, Tony.
Wait. So there's an episode that we don't know about.
That's correct.
Are you allowed to talk about it?
I am. What? It was an episode that they brought me back after not being on the show for literally almost an entire season. They brought me back at the end. And Tony V and a lot of my friends were saying, oh, my God, you're going to kill Tony Soprano. You're going to be the guy that can. And it certainly looked that way. Like, why did they bring me back? I wasn't on for like 13 episodes. I wasn't on. And out of nowhere, my manager calls me up. He goes, you're not going to believe this. They want you back. And I taped an episode where Gandolfini comes into the Butter Bing, sees me there, and goes,
Slow down. Slow down.
Okay.
This is really important to me. Like, this is like the most important thing in my life. I'm being serious. You have to understand.
Okay, I
watch this show over and over and over again. So.
Right.
Okay. All right. So this has never aired.
That's correct.
Okay, so tell me what the story is.
It's I've actually
what season
been beaten up in this is season 6 or 7. I get beat up really badly. And
by whom?
The chain with the lock.
Yeah, Frank. Ralphie.
Ralphie, right? I'm sorry. No, I'm wrong. It's the one where he beats me up with the singing fish. The Billy Bass.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Pussy.
He says,
big pussy. What do you think? This is a place of business. What are you doing with this? And he really, really beats me up with it badly, and I'm laying there. And the next couple scenes go by, and Tony Sirico, Paulie Walnuts, is standing in front of a hospital room. You don't see me. And he says, Tony, he don't want to see you. And Tony Soprano gives Paulie Walnuts the money and says, here, give this to him. And Tony Sirico, Paulie Walnut, says one of the funniest lines in panel history. Don't worry, Tony. I'll give it to him, and I'll take him to church on Sunday with my mother. I swear that's what he says. Like, I'll smooth it over.
Mm-hmm.
But he's quitting. He's quitting the Butta Bing. Like, who quits the mafia?
You can't.
Right? Who quits the mob? I quit because he beat me up one too many times. So almost a whole season goes by. They call me up, and they say, we want you back. And nobody knows why, and nobody knows anything. And I go to the read-through, and literally, I'm at the Butta Bing all by myself, and he comes in, and he stops dead in his tracks. He goes, what are you doing here? And I go, I actually say the words, Cleveland didn't work out.
Wow.
So I went to Cleveland, according to my lines, I went to Cleveland. And he goes, huh, okay. And he walks by. We shot that, and it never aired. So it was literally a minute-long scene.
So there wasn't an episode.
It was supposed to be in the final season, and it never aired because of whatever, budget cuts.
Okay, but wait a second. I want to get to the bottom of this. You said there was an entire episode that didn't air. You're saying this is just a scene.
No, I'm sorry. Just my scene. In the final season of The Sopranos, we taped a scene. I taped a scene that never made it on. I'm sorry.
Oh,
I'm sorry there was confusion.
I was creaming my pants thinking there was a lost episode of The Sopranos. I mean, is there a possibility that there is a lost episode of The Sopranos?
I don't believe so, no.
Well, I think James Gandolfini is the single greatest actor who has ever been, ever.
You might be right about that. Correct, sir, because his face, I mean, every episode is built around him. He carried that whole show, and his face was so filled with expression. Everything that he felt, you saw in his face. I know exactly what you're saying. You are correct.
And that includes, by the way,
he was our generation's Marlon Brando.
I'm going to go even further and say Tom Selleck.
He was a Marlboro man.
Was he really?
A Marlboro man.
Wow.
He really was. That was his first gig. It was on the magazine cover, the back of the magazine, pushing cigarettes. Right.
Let's get back to James Gandolfini. Now, that being said about Gandolfini, I maintain that the show, that he didn't find it until the second season.
That's correct.
Really?
You mean he didn't hit his stride, so to speak.
Yeah.
That's correct. I believe that.
There was a lightness. There was something very scripted in the first. Again, it's the best show that's ever been on television. But there was
Me too. I believe that.
But there was the first season. It just felt written, and it was actored. You could tell they were acting.
That's correct.
And they were being funny off the lines as opposed to internally.
It was written, the first seven episodes, maybe six, I'm not exactly sure, were written by a guy from Boston named Frank Renzulli.
Hmm.
And he left the show right around episode seven, first season, and they brought in this writing team, husband and wife, Robin Burgess. And somebody else, some guy, her husband, I forget who his name was. Yeah.
But it wasn't a
very interesting.
But not David Chase? Wasn't he running the room?
Yeah, I'm sure. David Chase was the, he was the executive producer. But the people that were actually the meat of the writing were a husband and wife team. I'm not kidding.
Hmm.
And they were exceptional. I thought they were exceptional. Because they came in, like right when you said, right at the end of the first season, they came in. And it changed the whole face of the show.
Yeah, I don't know if, again, you would know more than I do. I suspect that it had nothing to do with the writing. It had more to do with the actors owning the show and not the writers. You know, in television, the writer is king. And sometimes the writer can suffocate the actors.
That's correct.
And I think Gandolfini just began to own the character and own the show. I don't know anything. This is just having watched each episode 20 times, and I just think he arrived at an inner truth, that he just got to the point where he understood the character. And he didn't stop educating himself, right? I mean, he was in constant training as an actor.
He was amazing. He would be by himself on the set. He wasn't the kind, everybody asked me all the time, what was he like? What was he like? I said, you know what? It wasn't time for me to go, hey, I got a joke for you, buddy. No, no. He had his script in his hand. He was working with acting coaches.
Mm-hmm.
He was a student of the game, and he brought it. He brought his A game every day on the set. And I worked very, very closely with him many times. Many times it was just me and him. You saw him. He beats me up with the bucket of ice. All kinds of different ways I get beat up by him. And the phone episode was fascinating because they actually had a real phone that they wanted to hit me with. Not a real one, like a rubber phone that they bought from L.A. And it actually plugged in and everything.
Boy, Naomi Campbell, could she use one of those? That would have been funny 10 years ago.
That's right. But yeah, it was a mystical experience for me. Because I was hanging out with like Patty Scalfa and, you know, Bruce Springsteen was there and, you know, all kinds of different people where I would show up on the set. I know, you know, Siragusa, the guy that played for the Ravens, he was always hanging around.
What do you mean they were
hanging?
Remember
that big guy?
They were hanging around?
Yeah, watching the shoots. Yeah, a lot of them would sit up, but there was like a little coffee thing. You could sit up in the top and look down at the Bada Bing. And that's another thing. That guy thinks he died and went to heaven, the guy that owned that strip club.
I drive
because it was a sleazy little strip club in Lodi, New Jersey, in the middle of nowhere. And now it's the world-famous home of Tony Soprano's Bada Bing. And it's called the Satin Dolls.
Is that on Route 4 or Route 23?
It's on Route 16 in Lodi, right before you get to Hackensack. And you're not going to believe this. There's a toy store next door, right next door. And you know this from the episode it was in.
Don't tell
it's
me.
Named the Party Box.
The Party Box is where Big Pussy was shopping, and he ran into the Elvis impersonator. He had a whack.
That's
right?
Correct. That's correct.
He was with the. So how many of those were sets? So they shot at the Satin Dolls? That was not a...
They shot at the Satin Dolls. That was the strip club. And then the back room of the Bada Bing was there. The actual back room where we're looking at the Pie Oh My, the picture of Pie Oh My, and playing pool.
Mm-hmm.
And the bathroom where I'm taking the wand and checking for microphone bugs on the floor with Christopher. And that's all in that one building.
And it's still a strip club. It's still a strip club?
It was all a strip club. That was a real strip club. They would rent it out.
So
they would rent it out for the night.
So if I go to that strip club, you know, just because I'm a big fan of The Sopranos, how much is the VIP room?
You know what?
Because I'm a fan.
I'm not really sure, but there's a big foyer now where you walk in and is there any language restrictions on this?
Well, I would prefer if you didn't curse.
All right. Well, there's, you can get a G-string in there. Like, I got screwed in the Bada Bing. You can get, you know, there's a foyer there where you can get hats, you know, with boobs on them and stuff. And, you know, it's a all inclusive foyer where you can buy Sopranos memorabilia before you even walk into the bar. Oh yeah.
Wow.
Making a killing selling stuff that says Bada Bing on it.
I apologize for talking about The Sopranos. I really
not at all.
But it's
not at all. I love talking about it. I love it. You're exactly right. One of the best damn TV shows it was ever on, ever.
It was
just riveting.
It's the best.
It really was. You know, and the beauty is that he, you know, it was all Gandolfini. It was all to me. It was all Gandolfini. I mean, it was good actors around him, but man, he really was amazing. He really was. He was riveting to watch.
Can I ask you a stupid question?
Sure.
And I apologize. I'm going to apologize up front because this is going to be a really stupid question.
Sure.
Who am I talking to?
Frank Santorelli.
Oh, okay. Thank you. No. So this is my stupid.
And you are, and this is David. Feldman?
Something like
that. Oh, yeah. And by the way, I really did play Tevye and Fiddler on the Roof.
So did Don Marrera, by the way.
Isn't that no way?
Yeah.
Is that for real?
Yeah.
Oh, man, I can't wait to see him. That's hysterical. I was so much better than he was, though. I mean, come on. I was in the moment, man. I was in the moment. I was Tevye.
When did you play Tevye?
I was 18 years old. I was a senior, 17. I was a senior in high school.
This proves my theory that Italians and Jews, if you're going to marry...
Absolutely. I am an honorary Jew for that to hundreds and hundreds of Jewish people in Cleveland. They will forever love me because, you know, dear God, did you have to make my poor old horse lose his shoe just before the Sabbath? It's enough. It's enough. Isn't it enough? Isn't it enough? You give me five daughters and a life of poverty. What do you got against my horse? There's comedy, man. There's comedy. Oh, yeah. And I remember Yogi Greenberg. Yeah, that was his name. No kidding.
Yogi
Greenberg's father came up to me in the hallway once in high school. He just happened to be there. He goes, how are you going to play this? How are you going to play this? You're Italian. How are you going to play this? You know, he was outraged, you know, that it wasn't a Jewish guy to play in this role. It was a super, super mega Italian guy, you know. Hey, he just couldn't get his head around it.
You're getting even for James Caan playing Santino.
There you go. Absolutely.
James Caan was a Jew. Nobody realizes
that. You know what? You're right. A lot of people don't know that. Now, I was on Las Vegas with James Caan. Las Vegas with James Caan. I was in the pilot. Absolutely. I was his bodyguard.
Was the commission that too? Am I thinking? Michael Chiklis?
No, he was not. No, your facts are uncoordinated.
I know. Yes. Let's get back.
But yeah.
By the way, Jews and Italians in Cleveland, yes. I know firsthand because I have relatives in Cleveland. The Jews and the Italians.
Do you really?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
No kidding.
Yeah, yeah. And the Jews and the Italians worked very well together.
They do.
In certain businesses that were not legitimate.
That's correct. And they're both extremely hairy people, which is the link between the two.
And I don't recommend intermarriage between Italians and Jews because it's yin and yin. It's the same energy.
Right.
And so there's going to
be. Well, I was best man at Sam Greenfield's wedding. Do you know Sam Greenfield?
He's like a comic turned radio guy, right?
That's exactly right. I was his best man.
Is he
one
right
of the
wing?
Funniest moments.
Is he right
What's
wing?
What's that?
Is he right wing?
Oh, he's not. He is okay. Not. No, no. He's on our side.
Okay.
He's one of the good guys. He had a wedding, and I was one of the guys holding the canopy. And so here comes the rabbi, and he's speaking in, is it Yiddish? It's not Yiddish, is it? Is it Hebrew that you speak at a wedding?
You speak Hebrew.
Hebrew. Okay, so he's speaking Hebrew.
Unless it's a reformed marriage, and then it's Latin.
Okay, yeah, he's speaking the Hebrew, and in the middle, he says, Barbara Singer, Sam Greenfield of 128 West 96th Street, New York, New York, 10011. He had to read their address. He had to say it in the middle of all this Hebrew. And everyone laughed. He said 10011. It was almost like watching Hollywood Squares when they would give the.
He
said it, and everyone laughed. And he looked at everybody incredulous and said, "I said something funny."
Right,
like
Spiegel.
Scolding everybody in the room. Oh,
the Spiegel catalog, Chicago 6060609.
That's it. That's what I meant. He goes 10011, and we cracked up. And he said, "I said something funny." Like he was not happy that we were laughing at this part of the. The wedding.
I wonder if does the Spiegel catalog still exist? Because you just grew up. If you're our age, you grew up hearing
the Spiegel catalog. Absolutely.
Our listeners have no idea what we're talking about.
That's right. Dicker and Dicker of Beverly Hills. Remember that one? Hollywood Squares.
Dicker and Dicker of Hollywood Squares. That would be like Carol Merrill or
That's right.
Jay Ward or Johnny Olson would say Dickery
Johnny
Dicker.
Olson, right, right. Unbelievable. Yeah. Don Pardo.
I wanted a Dicker and Dicker all night, Carol Merrill. I know. Let me ask you a stupid question going back to James Gandolfini. This is a stupid question.
Sure.
Who was he on The Sopranos? No.
When what character was he?
When he was beating you up.
He was beating me up.
Okay,
yes,
so I suspect that there was no laughter.
No. No. There was a limited crew in the Butta Bing, and a lot of times I worked with him. Limited crew, limited actual people sitting at the bar. A lot of times they had a lot of guys, you know, sitting around the actual perimeter of the bar. And that was fascinating. You know, guys getting hired for $120 a day to watch naked girls dance.
Mm-hmm.
Literally, and just pretend they were sitting there drinking. And it was fascinating to watch and to be a part of that. And there was actual naked girls. And that was unsettling.
For you.
A lot of guys, you know, I think that a lot of the women crew would comment about how the men of the crew, the guys that hang the lights and such, would act weird on those days because there was literally naked women stuff.
And the men and the men would act weird in that they would.
Their blood was up, their blood pressure was up, you know, thinking about sex. They just were not clear-headed, and they, you know, were making mistakes and forgetting things and not being themselves. That's what one woman crew member said. Oh, boy, we're going to the Butta Bing. You know, all the guys are going to be acting stupid today.
How many days were the shoot? How many hours were
for me? Sometimes three, sometimes 4 days for me to shoot my stuff. Absolutely.
And
took a month to shoot a whole episode.
Really?
It took a month. Absolutely. A little more than a month. And then when they went to Rome and stuff like that, it was all bets were off. They were there for 6 months, I think.
Commendatory.
Right.
So that was David Chase's cameo in the episode. But let me ask you, so you're surrounded by naked women all day.
Not surrounded, but like on the stage, literally on the stage, and sweating because they couldn't run the air conditioners because the air conditioners would mess with the sound. So the big giant air conditioners that would normally be running in a place like that were off. So it was literally 100 degrees in there.
Hot, and so sweaty.
Hot, sweaty, naked girls. Absolutely. Right.
Let me ask you a stupid question. Okay. This is, and I apologize, but when
sure, you're apologizing.
Women are the ones who don't have penises, right?
That's correct.
Okay. When you, when you're surrounded by naked, beautiful strippers, at some point you get into guys, you get bored and you want to blow a man, right?
That's not true.
Oh, okay.
That is incorrect.
No, but I mean, at some point you get acclimated to just seeing naked women and you are no longer right. How many times can you sneak off and jerk off in your car? I mean, at some point, doesn't it wear off after a while?
Well, you know, I've often thought of announcing that I'm gay, even though I'm not, just because I think it'd be a good career move for me.
Yeah.
You know, a big guy like me from Cleveland being gay would be absolutely shocking to the show business world.
Okay.
And so it would get me a lot of press, I think.
We'll do it.
But I know exactly.
But at some point, do you forget that there are these naked women around you and you just kind of...
Well, yeah, because I'm supposed to be acting and, you know, I'm sort of moving around and stuff. But the beauty is people have asked me many times, how do you know which, because they use strippers and then they use regular actresses. And the regular actresses would put a robe on during the break and the regular strippers would just stand there.
Hmm.
And they didn't care. And they would talk about how their car broke down on the, you know, New Jersey Turnpike. You know, just regular conversations. I mean, they weren't totally naked, but they might as well have been.
I would
tell. There were a couple episodes we shot.
Are you circumcised? Are you circumcised?
Me? Yes, I am.
Oh, because you know, usually when a woman tells me her car broke down, I say, "Why don't you look under my hood, and I'll show you how to fix it." Kill me, please. Somebody just kill me. I don't deserve to be talking to Frank Santorelli.
Yes, yes, you do. Can I tell the listeners who you are?
No.
David Feldman is one of the regarded as one of the funniest guys around. And that's not an exaggeration. Your name comes up all the time, but not just with Kylie, with Tony G. And, you know, I talk to Paul Kozlowski every once in a while and, you know, people like that. And so anyway. We love you, man, and we're pulling for you to come up from the bottom. We're hoping that somehow you come out of this doldrums that you're in
for the past 20 years.
for the past quarter century.
Do you know what the hardest thing? My children are into comedy. They're big, huge fans of comedy, and the hardest thing for kids in their 20s is to discover that their father might actually be a little cool.
Like, yes.
And they can't accept the fact. Like, sometimes we'll go somewhere and somebody they really respect in the comedy world will sing my praises. And they hate
you. Boy, you nailed that right. My daughters want nothing to do with comedy, though.
Oh, you're right.
They've seen Tony V. They've seen a couple comedians that they know working with me. They've seen maybe three or four shows. They really are not students of comedy. But you're absolutely right. People will talk about Frank Santorelli in their presence, and they'll be like, "Well, I guess my father is sort of somebody."
But your daughter, you have two daughters, and they don't want to be comedians. I'm thinking you were so abusive, they want to be strippers. They're just going right to your daughters don't want to be comedians.
Yeah, Chris Rock says that. Chris Rock says that in his act.
What does he say?
He says, if your daughter's a stripper, you screwed up, man. There's no two ways about it.
You know, that's true and not true because.
Oh, sure. I mean, they're making $900 a night, you know, and they're not having sex with anybody. All they're doing is dancing in front of these goofy guys that think, you know, this chick's coming home with me tonight, man, you know.
So
I gave her $20.
Yeah, I mean, how many of those, I'm curious, because I think there was a time when they had daddy issues.
Sure.
And now I think it's, I don't go to strip joints.
Right.
Even though I'm almost completely divorced, I'm still very cheap.
Right.
I'm very cheap. I will not pay for... Just,
you're not cheating.
No, I just won't go to a strip club.
How can you afford to have this show?
That's true. The amount of money I'm paying you to do this.
I know. Bitcoins. That's not bad. I can do that.
I can't go to a strip club. I just would find it.
No, I can't either. I always thought it was weird. I always thought it was deeply, deeply weird to go to a strip club. Right. I didn't really get it. You know. But that's a whole other story. That is an entirely different story.
I would go to a hooer. I love that. Frank.
Some of your listeners don't know exactly what a hooer is.
It's when you lost your eye and he kills the stripper.
And what's a hooer, Tony. A hooer.
All this over a hooer.
Right, right.
Oh, is it dead hooer? Yeah, dead hooer. All this over a dead hooer. I didn't know, and then we're going to wrap it up. And next time you're going to come on the show,
yes.
We're not going to talk about The Sopranos.
Okay.
We're just going to talk only about James Gandolfini. I promise you. You have my word. I don't want to get you.
Okay.
I don't want to pigeon.
Hey, listen, I'll come on and we should do a weekly report, a weekly Sopranos report.
Would you do that?
Absolutely. Absolutely, I would. I love talking about The Sopranos. You know, people even used to go, "Who are you on the show? Who are you? What did you play?" Like that. Now, people like you have seen the shows 20 times. It was on A&E with the sex and the violence taken out so grandmothers could watch it. Now I'm in a mall and people go, "Hey, you're the guy that got beat up in the Butter Baby. Yes, I am. You're the guy that used to get beat up. We felt so bad for you. One guy goes, hey, man, how can you not beat him up? You're bigger than he is. And I go, dude, you know it's not real, right? It's not a real show. He's like, you should beat him up. You're bigger than he is. What's that about?
Hey,
yeah.
I'm going to wrap it up. I'm going to ask you another question. This time I'm going to apologize to my listeners before I ask it, because I'm repeating something that I say anytime. This is this is the truth, but I've said it a million times on this show, so my listeners have to put up with it. I didn't know that The Sopranos was funny until 5 years ago. This is a true story. I was watching it with
sure.
I'm telling you, I used to watch it over and over again, and it would just wash over me. It was so real,
right.
and it seemed so true that
right.
there was nothing. I knew they had funny, you know, one-liners that they would make each other laugh with.
Sure.
But I never got the visual puns and the irony and the
sure.
Did you and until I sat down with my mother, and she, you know, she loves the show, and she would laugh hysterically, and I'd go, what are you laughing at? And she says, you're not paying attention to this. You're not seeing how funny this
right,
is.
Right, right.
And I started watching it all over again and go, oh my God, it is
yeah, one specific episode that I one thing that Ralphie says at the dinner table. They're sitting there eating, and he goes, I was going to be an architect. And Gandolfini's eating, and he almost spits up his food. You know, that, to me, was one of the funniest moments in the show, the whole history of the show. I was going to be an architect. He says it, like, real wistfully. You know, he's, like, being wistful. If a guy who murders people can be wistful, he was. Right. I was going to be an architect.
And whoever dressed Ralphie is a genius. Whoever picked it, because it was all Ralph Lauren outlet. It was all right. from the Ralph Lauren outlet store.
Right.
And it was just, it was perfect. The way he dressed, that, it was just so.
And, you know, I got a bunch of stories, man. I could come out and tell you really funny stories, man. So, yeah, definitely. I'll come out and talk about Sopranos. We can talk only about Sopranos if you want.
Well, let's do it.
Let me just tell you this one real quick. Okay. I was in the first four episodes. If you watch, first four, real quick, boom, 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 and then nothing for almost 20 episodes goes by. I come back in season three, and that's when he hits me in the face with the chain, mm-hmm. pokes me in the stomach with the pool stick, and that whole scene. And they kill the stripper out back. All right. When I showed up that day, Tony Sirico saw me. He was smoking a cigarette. He was all by himself. He looks at me. He goes, you must have done something right. And he wasn't kidding. Everybody found out I was a comedian. They were in abject horror. Like, how the hell did this Yahoo get on this show?
Mm-hmm.
I kid you not. They were not. Michael Imperioli, same thing. He kind of looked at me and said, someone says you do stand up. And I said, yeah. And he didn't say anything. He just sat there looking at me like with disdain.
Well, God,
so anyway,
God bless you, Frank Santorelli.
Thanks, man. Let
me wrap this up. Frank Santorelli is a tremendous comedian. He'll be at the Mohegan Sun in Uncasville, Connecticut on December 14th. Go see Frank Santorelli at the Mohegan Sun in Uncasville, Connecticut on December 14th. Go see him on December 3rd in Newport, Rhode Island at the Grand Hyatt, December 3rd. He is a great, great comedian. And do you have a website?
FrankSantorelli.net.
And how do you spell Santorelli?
S-A-N-T-O-R-E-L-L-I.
And do you have a
Santorelli?
Do you have a Facebook thing?
I do. I'm on Facebook.
And are you on Twitter?
No.
Ah, okay.
I am not.
All right.
But yeah, anytime you want me to come on, man, anytime, call me up and I'll come on.
I love you, buddy. I miss you.
I love you too, man.
Thanks for doing this.
You got it.
Bye.
Coming up, the senior editor for the New Republic, Jeet Heer, talks about alt-right comedy, if you want to call it that. Please friend me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter. Give us a good review on iTunes, by the way. That's really important. Do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com. You'll see an Amazon banner. Click on it and shop away. We get a small percentage of everything you purchase. And while you're on Amazon shopping through the David Feldman Show website, please buy gift subscriptions for the New York Times, The Nation Magazine, The Washington Post. Support your local newspapers. You can buy gift subscriptions for mainstream media, which I believe in. Support mainstream media. We need the New York Times. We need the Washington Post. We need the Nation Magazine. That's not a mainstream magazine, but we need the Nation Magazine. Support real journalism. Support real journalism. Hey, get a subscription to the New Republic. Coming up, senior editor from the New Republic, Jeet Heer. Anybody who's a member of a protected class knows when they are being baited, specifically through jokes. If you're black, Hispanic, LGBTQ, Jewish, Arab, Muslim, Hindu, Sikh, handicapped, you know when jokes are more than just jokes. For years, I have complained that people like Donald Trump, Ann Coulter, or Rush Limbaugh would often say horrible things, and then when they get heat for saying these horrible things, they always fall back to, "I was joking." I find this doubly offensive because I'm a comedy writer. Horrible things are intrinsically funny. In fact, the more horrible, the funnier it is. But people like Donald Trump, Ann Coulter, and Rush Limbaugh don't get to be chameleons. When it comes to being horrible, when it comes to saying horrible things, you don't get to be a chameleon. You're not allowed to say horrible things as a pundit or a provocateur, and then when the heat gets turned up, you don't get to change your stripes and say, "I'm a comedian." Ann Coulter at the big Comedy Central roast for Rob Lowe this past Labor Day proved she's no comedian. Donald Trump at the Al Smith dinner right before the election proved he is no comedian. Rush Limbaugh was given a late-night show on CBS 20 years ago and proved without any shadow of a doubt that he, too, is no comedian. And by the way, just because people are laughing, it doesn't mean something funny is going on. It probably means the people in the audience are nervous. I went to a couple of Trump rallies this year, and over I heard people say, "He's joking. He doesn't mean it." Well, look at who he's meeting with at Trump Tower right now. Look at who he's making Attorney General. He means it. I've never been able to articulate all this as succinctly as our guest Jeet Heer did in last week's New Republic. It's an article he wrote entitled, "Ironic Nazis Are Still Nazis." Jeet Heer is a senior editor at the New Republic. He has been published in a wide array of journals, including The New Yorker, The Paris Review, and VQR. And he joins us today via Skype from Regina, Canada. Thank you for doing this.
Actually, the pronunciation is Regina, but most people who aren't from Regina avoid that because it sounds a little bit too much like vagina. That's the most famous joke about Regina, which I guess you could make if you're from Regina. But yes.
Yeah, I kind of heard that, but I was hoping it was... I would assume it has something to do with Queen Elizabeth, right?
That's right. Yeah. The city was named after Queen Victoria.
Queen Victoria.
It's called the Queen City. Yeah. It was, founded during the reign of Queen Victoria. And so, and we still have statues of her up because this is Canada and we're still a colonial country. So,
yes.
Yeah. But I think my mom, who's from India and has a bit of an accent, always pronounces Regina as vagina, which causes all sorts of Oedipal issues in my household.
Well, Queen Victoria's children went on to become the kings and queens of practically every country in Europe leading up to World War I. So she had an amazing Regina. She really
did.
All right. Okay. So we're joking, and that's one of the reasons I'm talking with you. And I loved your piece in the New Republic. It It just articulated everything I can't say myself. Let's go step by step, and sure. I don't know if I'm pronouncing this properly. Define Lusion Press. We keep hearing this word all of a sudden from the alt-right. What is Lusion Press?
It's a phrase from German that gained popularity in the 20s and 30s among Nazis, who basically thought that, you know, the press that criticizes Nazis is lying and it's controlled by the Jews. And so they came up with this phrase, which literally means lying press or Lusion Press. And that phrase has gained great popularity recently among the European far right and is also coming to America, which is slightly disturbing. But you hear it among Donald Trump fans. And most recently, there's a gathering of people called the alt-right, who are very hardcore Donald Trump supporters. And I think it's fair to characterize them as Nazis. But one of them, Richard Spencer, gave a speech in Washington at a conference they held. And he ended the speech by saying, "Hail Trump, hail our people, hail victory." And members of the audience started to give the Nazi salute. And then Spencer, he also used the phrase Lusion Press during the during that speech. And then people, he was asked about this, and he said that the Nazi salute was clearly done in the spirit of irony and exuberance. So when people are saying, you know, Heil Trump, that's just a joke.
What does Sieg Heil mean? It means hail victory, right?
Hail victory, hail victory. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I mean, Spencer was basically saying the Nazi slogans, except in English, right? He was saying, "Hail Trump," you know, which is Heil Hitler, "Hail victory," which is Sieg Heil.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So this is a shining example of somebody hiding behind irony or satire. After 9/11, we were told that we might be living in a post-ironic world for comedians. I'm wondering if, with the election of Trump, whether or not we may be living in a post-ironic world where people might have to say what they mean. You write about the way grisly would-be humor is intermixed with bigotry. We're seeing this kind of would-be humor intermixed with bigotry at these alt-right conferences. What exactly is the alt-right? We keep hearing about that. Why do you find it dangerous? Why is it dangerous to use humor to disguise bigotry?
Well, the alt-right is a kind of amorphous term, but it really refers to this sort of wing of the American right that is openly racist, that doesn't hide the fact that they believe that America should be a white country. They're white nationalists. And they often use stereotypical humor against their political enemies. So if you're a Jewish writer and you're on Twitter, it's highly likely that you get harassed by these alt-right Twitter accounts, which often use like pictures of Pepe the Frog, but will also like take a photoshopped image of you and show you in a concentration camp with like Trump happily pulling the gas chamber lever. And I think what's interesting about this movement is that these are kind of ironic Nazis. That, like, if you challenge them about this stuff, they'll say, like, "Oh, can't you take a joke?" Fortunately, so far, they aren't, like, literal Nazis in the sense of, like, marching in the streets, forming paramilitary, or, like, killing people. But there is a kind of ideology of bigotry there, and it often deploys humor, which I think is very interesting.
Yeah, the thing in your article that was chilling was you write that the use of jokes to cloak bigotry, basically that's what they're doing, they're cloaking their bigotry by saying they're joking. You write, it's actually indistinguishable from how the actual Nazis of the early 20th century behaved. So do we know how the Nazis behaved when it came to fooling and joking around?
Yes, we do, actually, because we obviously have a lot of records, historical records of Nazis. And I think a lot of their humor, they made cartoons as, you know, they do now. They had these magazines where they portrayed Jews and other so-called inferior races with like caricature. And but more than that, like the sort of whole rhetoric of Nazism always had this like element of hyperbole, of exaggeration, of, you know, like pushing the boundary, of being kind of offensive. Someone who really analyzes very well was the philosopher Jean-Paul Sartre, the French philosopher who lived in the early 20th century, who lived in occupied France during the Nazi occupation. And in 1944, just as the Americans were, Allied forces were liberating France, published a very important book on anti-Semitism called Anti-Semite and Jew in 1944. And one of the things that points that Sartre makes is that the Nazis often will say things that are very exaggerated or comic and that aren't totally meant to be taken seriously. So that he said, never believe that anti-Semites are completely unaware of the absurdity of their replies.
Explain that to me, because that was hard for me to grasp. I think you were writing in your piece that they're less interested in a conversation, that they're more interested in the totalitarianism of it all. And they use humor to break down logic and conversation and to make the Jew or whomever feel frightened.
That's right.
Yeah.
I mean, I think that, in some ways, fascism is not politics as we normally understand it, which is, having policy, making rules. It's a politics of willfulness, of absurdity, of imposing your will. So to say, the Jew is a cockroach is not a factual statement or a literal statement, but an attempt to impose a will on reality, using some of the same techniques as humor. And I think in some ways the use of absurdity and fantastic rhetoric by the Nazis is a way of breaking down normal reality that we live in and introducing a world where violence is possible, right? Where there's no rules, there's no logic. So therefore, we can kill people.
Wow. So it makes you slippery. There's a slipperiness to this.
There's a slipperiness. There's a breakdown of rationality. There's a breakdown of, sort of conventional ideas. And there's also kind of deniability about it too, right? And a willingness to be challenged on factual grounds.
I'm old enough now to have seen a couple of comedy booms. There's one going on in America right now. And it kind of started under Obama. And I remember thinking, what's everybody laughing at? Everybody wants to be a comedian. Everybody's laughing. They don't quite question what exactly they're laughing at unless they're, quote unquote, politically correct. There have been a lot of comics who complain about the language police. What is the virtue to political correctness? What is the virtue to language police?
Well, I mean, it's a tough kind of question, because I do think that there's a way in which humor makes everything allowable, but I also think that comedy itself, like anything else, can be criticized. And I think it really depends on the intent, right? Someone like Mel Brooks in The Producers is doing very kind, at the time, very edgy comedy. But I mean, the thing about The Producers is he's not making fun of Jews. He's making fun of Nazis. But once you get into a position where you're making, you're not a member of a group. And in fact, you have sort of a privileged position in society and you're making fun of people who are somehow threatened, you get into very dangerous territory unless, the humor is done with great sort of intelligence and sophistication. Nobody likes to be criticized, but I do think that there's a value in taking comedy seriously, in taking comedy and trying to understand why it is that we're laughing at what we're laughing at. I don't know if you want to call that political correctness or not, but I mean, I do think comedy is something we should be thinking about rather.
Yeah, and are you punching down? The big question is, are you punching down? And punching down means, is the laugh coming at the expense of somebody who is frightened?
That's right. Yeah. It becomes very problematic when you are punching down. And I think that that's worth, I think that's definitely something that's worth saying and worth arguing about. And I think that people who just hide behind the excuse of, well, it's just a joke, I don't know if they have a leg to stand on, because jokes are part of conversation and they have meaning. And it's often worth inquiring what that meaning is.
Right. You write that humor gives racists, I love this, plausible deniability. So if the racism is challenged, there's a prepared rejoinder, can't you take a joke? As though a joke is just words.
And I think that's something many people have experienced and gone through. And I mean, I think it's precisely because comedy is powerful and such a part of human experience that we have to sometimes step back and ask, well, what does a joke actually mean? What is it actually based on?
Yeah, we're almost at the end of our time here. Who was, I hope I'm pronouncing this right, who was André Gide and who was Céline?
André Gide was a French writer who was very experimental and wrote, and you know, he had been a criminal and a thief and wrote very explicitly about the sort of like underworld of life. And Céline was also another French writer, sort of in some ways very similar.
When did they live? When did they live?
In the mid 20th century. So they really flourished in the 1930s and 40s and subsequently. But Céline, you know, wrote these wonderful novels, but then in like 1938, he wrote a book called Trifles for a Massacre, which was an anti-Semitic tract and which made like astonishing claims. He said the Pope was really Jewish, the nation of England was Jewish, Jews were responsible for the downfall of Napoleon and the rise of surrealism. And André Gide, who respected Céline as a writer, you know, wrote a review where he said, well, this is obviously all a joke. Like, you know, Céline is an intelligent man. Intelligent people can't possibly mean this. And unfortunately, it wasn't a joke. Céline very much meant his anti-Semitism. And when he wanted Germany and France to cooperate, and when Germany conquered France, he became a leading collaborator and continued to encourage attacks on Jews when there was a government in power that had the ability to do so and did so. So Céline is almost a perfect example of what Sartre was talking about someone whose anti-Semitism seems like a joke, is very exaggerated. And he's a very funny writer. He actually had a profound influence on Philip Roth. In Portnoy's Complaint, is kind of influenced by Céline.
In a positive way or a negative?
In a positive way. Like Céline has this sort of like power of like exaggerated rhetoric and stream of consciousness, which Roth and other writers sort of borrowed from.
Did Roth know about the anti-Semitism? I would assume he did.
I am assuming he did, yeah. I mean, Céline is unquestionably a great writer, but I think it's interesting that some of his, you know, tendencies, once it latched onto hatred of the Jews, like really like led him to a very dark and terrible place.
Yeah, it's interesting. You write that André Gide just assumed something that was really horrible had to be satire.
Yeah, yeah.
And right now we have conservatives who thought Stephen Colbert, when he was doing the Colbert Report, was for real.
Right? That's right. Yeah.
And the Onion,
they like to forget the thing.
The Onion is often linked to by conservatives who think it's real. What role does a satirist have in a culture that no longer is capable of distinguishing between truth and fiction?
That's a really interesting comment. And I think, I mean, in some ways, in the new reality, I think the best satirist would simply be doing factual descriptions, because what could be more absurd than the reality that we're living through? And so in some ways, like, satire needs to tone it down, because you can't compete with that absurdity.
Is satire an irony? I can never tell the difference between the two, but it's basically saying what you don't mean to say what you think.
Oh, well, yeah, that's sort of like irony. Yeah. And then, yeah, and I think, I think it has that element to it, yes. And I do think that, I mean, I think the new era is a real challenge to satirists. I think that they need to be thinking about how to approach it, because, like, Trump himself as a satirical figure. And it's gotten away with a lot because people who like other aspects of what he's saying will say that the more distasteful stuff is just a joke. Well, it could well turn out that the joke's on us.
Yeah, we're out of time. I just, I'm a comedian and a comedy writer. I think people need to get their news from the New Republic and
thank you.
And the New York Times. And shows like this are the dessert. You gotta eat your vegetables before you laugh. And when I watch CNN and MSNBC and they're laughing and they have funny people on, they're really not performing a public service. Jeet Heer is a senior editor over at the New Republic. He's the author of several books, one of which is In Love with Art, Francois Mouly's Adventures in Comics with Art Spiegelman. It's published by Coach House Books. And Sweet Lechery, Essays, Profiles, and Reviews, published by Porcupine's Quill. Very quickly, Francois Mouly. Who was Francois Mouly?
She's an editor at The New Yorker. She's the art editor, and she basically is in charge of the covers. So all those great New Yorker covers, which we laugh at, and which are very great satire.
I'm going to have to cut you off. We're out of time. Jeet Heer is a senior editor at The New Republic. Thank you for joining us.
The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
That's our show. Please friend me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter, give us a good review on iTunes. We need those. If you want to help me and you don't have money, just tell your friends, give us a good review on iTunes, and make sure you're spreading this show to all your friends. Help us go viral from the Showbiz Studios in downtown Manhattan. That'll do it for us.